powered by the Montana Television Network. This is the 10 o'clock news on Q2, Montana's news leader.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining us on this historic day in Montana. I'm Janelle Slade. Jay is off tonight. For the first time as the nation's commander and chief, President Donald Trump touched down in Big Sky Country.
I'm excited to just feel that energy and get that recharge.
A lot of love for Trump out there.
We were actually in line for the last 4 hours.
I couldn't believe that he would come to a smaller city like this.
Senator Daines and Congressman Gianforte do not represent me.
Absolutely, there's a lot of gray area here. It's not just black and white.
He's going to be your next senator.
What's good for America is great for Montana.
I said to my people, why didn't you get a larger arena?
And we are gonna make America great again.
Now, Trump launched scathing criticism of U.S. Senator John Tester as he threw support to Tester's Republican opponent, Matt Rosendale. Now, during the 1-hour and 5-minute monologue, the president fired up the crowd with talk of his political accomplishments and political foes. MTN's Mike Dennison was there.
President Trump hit the stage shortly before 4:30 p.m. and quickly went to the first order of business, promoting Matt Rosendale and bashing Senator Tester as an obstacle to the Trump agenda.
It's time to retire liberal Democrat John Tester.
Trump and other GOP speakers listed Tester's many sins, voting against the repeal of Obamacare, against Supreme Court Justice Neil Gorsuch, and against the Republican tax cut bill last year.
I see John Tester saying such nice things about me. I say, yeah, but he never votes for me. He never votes.
But the president also remarked on what he called two landmark veterans' health bills passed by Congress this year that Tester supported and helped write, a fact quickly noted Thursday by the Tester campaign.
Those are two bills that the president signed into law and were actually written by Senator Tester. So we were glad to hear that he was proud of those accomplishments and knew the impact on Montana's veterans.
20 minutes into the speech, Trump turned mostly to his own record, taking credit for a strong economy, job growth, and low unemployment. He also lauded his overtures to the likes of North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un and Russian President Vladimir Putin, and assailed our NATO allies as not paying their fair share of defense costs and killing us on trade. But he got perhaps his loudest ovations when he talked about stopping illegal immigration and securing the U.S. border.
A vote for the Democrats in November is a vote to let MS-13 run wild in our communities, to let drugs pour into our cities, and to take jobs and benefits away from our hardworking Americans, and we're not letting it happen. If you want to have a country, if you want borders, how about borders? Wouldn't it be nice to have borders?
Trump flew into Great Falls on Air Force One and brought Republican U.S. Senator Steve Daines and Congressman Greg Gianforte with him from Washington. Not long after the speech, he was back on the plane and jetting his way back to the East Coast. The president spoke loud and clear to his base here in Great Falls with an aggressive Put America First message. The question this November, however, will be how that plays with the entire electorate. Reporting from Great Falls, Mike Dennison, MTN News.
Thanks so much, Mike. Now, President Trump also getting a big welcome from an unlikely source, Senator John Tester's campaign. Montanans for Tester placed an ad in 14 state newspapers and is even running a statewide radio ad. Now, that ad thanks the president and highlights the 16 bills Tester sponsored or co-sponsored and then the president signed. It reads, quote, "Welcome to Montana and thank you, President Trump, for supporting John's legislation to help veterans and first responders hold the VA accountable and get rid of waste, fraud, and abuse in the federal government." Well, MTN brought you nearly 2.5 hours of live coverage today, from touchdown to rally to takeoff. Well, tonight, MTN's Jill Valley brings a different view of today's presidential visit.
I was the only broadcast reporter who got the chance to tag along with the national press pool today. It was a chance to get closer to the president and watch the national correspondents at work and see the logistics of greeting a president. We met those other reporters as they got off of Air Force One, and we gathered under the wing of the big plane. We waited for the president to come down the stairs to the dignitaries, waiting to greet him there, and then he got into that waiting armored vehicle. And that is when we literally ran to the media buses and got into the motorcade headed toward the arena. Every intersection was blocked and guarded by law enforcement. The crowds lined the streets all the way to the Four Seasons Arena. We then set up in the press pen, where most reporters got their laptops set up and started live tweeting or sending stories to their newsrooms across the country. We did have to leave the arena before the president was finished speaking because, again, we had to get back on that bus so we were ready to get in line with the presidential motorcade. As we drove back to the airport, those streets were still lined with people, all taking pictures and video of this procession. It was pretty impressive, with giant black SUVs, all the buses, and the emergency vehicles with all those flashing lights escorting the president. I spoke with the CNN reporter on the bus. He said the trick is to make it back to the airport in time to get the president walking back up into the plane, and sometimes he'll stop and talk to reporters. I, of course, was hoping that would happen, but we didn't make it in time. My biggest takeaway from all this, they don't waste time. Once Air Force One lands, it is full speed ahead, and the president doesn't wait for the media. In Great Falls, Jill Valley, MTN News.
Thanks so much, Jill. Now, the lights are down, the floors are swept clean, and the barriers are almost gone outside the Four Seasons Arena. The quiet city of Great Falls is returning to normalcy tonight. And for that, we check in with Q2's Samantha Harrelson.
And just like that, President Trump's visit to Great Falls, Montana is over. It comes after over a week of planning by the Secret Service, the Great Falls Police Department, the Sheriff's Office, Montana Highway Patrol, so many state, local, and federal agencies coming together to make sure this trip went smoothly. And now in Great Falls, a sigh of relief. While it's exciting to have a president come to the state, it's also, as we said, a lot of work. The president got here around 3:30 on Thursday afternoon, and from then it was a whirlwind. He took his motorcade to the Four Seasons Arena, where he spoke to a crowd of supporters for about an hour before coming back up to the Great Falls Airport to head out this evening. For now, in Great Falls, Samantha Harrelson, MTN News.
All right, thanks, Sammy. While President Trump was headed to Montana today, Environmental Protection Chief Scott Pruitt resigned following a wave of scandals. CBS News correspondent Mola Lenghi has more from the White House on the reaction to this fifth departure from the Trump cabinet.
Well, thank you, Montana. What a place.
President Trump held a 70-minute campaign-style rally in Montana Thursday, but didn't once mention the resignation of his EPA chief, Scott Pruitt. Earlier, the president told reporters there was no final straw. He said the resignation was Pruitt's own decision, despite controversies over his spending, ethics, and travel. Pruitt was facing a House Oversight Committee investigation, 5 Inspector General audits, 7 pending Inspector General reviews, and 2 Government Accountability Office inquiries. Pruitt wrote in his resignation letter, he was leaving in part because the unrelenting attacks on me personally, my family, are unprecedented and have taken a sizable toll on all of us.
Thank you, Scott, very much. EPA is doing really, really well.
For months, President Trump had offered his unwavering support. Republican Senator Jim Inhofe from Pruitt's home state of Oklahoma released a statement commending him for ending the burdensome regulations that have stifled economic growth across the country. There was also fierce criticism of Pruitt from environmental groups and politicians on both sides of the aisle.
We've seen scandal after scandal that has come out of his administration.
Vermont Independent Senator Bernie Sanders released a statement saying Scott Pruitt was the worst EPA administrator in the history of the agency. His temporary replacement, Deputy Chief Andrew Wheeler, is a former lobbyist for the coal industry who questions the extent of man's effect on climate change. Mola Lenghi, CBS News, The White House.
The EPA Inspector General's office is now evaluating its audits of Pruitt that he has stepped down. Back here in Billings, Senator John Tester talked tariffs today. Uncertainty, the word Tester heard over and over as he met with Montana agricultural and transportation leaders here in Billings. Now, both farmers and ranchers say their markets are down and the uncertainty of tariff changes will put more pressure on their industries.
A lot of the things that are happening now could end up being really devastating in the future. For instance, if they start building infrastructure towards other countries other than the U.S., that could have some long-term impacts that won't be turned around by just an eraser on a pencil or a different perspective from policy from D.C.
And Esther added he's glad President Trump was in Montana today to see what's happening in rural America regarding agriculture and business. Well, turning to weather, Bob, it was hot in Great Falls today as thousands stood in line, and more heat is on the way, even possibly triple digits.
Yeah, this is just the beginning of it. Let's go back about 4 or 5 days ago and show you the way things shaped up earlier this week on Monday. We had the jet stream in this position here. The cool air was coming down from Canada. We had scattered showers and thunderstorms riding that jet stream. But now since then, look what has happened. The jet stream has retreated. The hot air down in the deep southwest has made its way all the way up into Montana. And so that heat is expanding, and it's going to continue to do so. So here's some things to think about as we get hot the next 2 days. Here's some safety things. Just slow down. Dress for summer. Wear light-colored clothing. Watch what you eat, not the really heavy stuff. Drink plenty of water. Stay out of direct sunlight. And air-conditioned places is the place to go when you get overheated. And take a look at this. This is tomorrow's forecast. 99 in Billings. Look at all those hundreds up in the north. We'll chat more about that coming up in a few more minutes. Janelle?
All right. Thanks so much, Bob. Well, one man is dead after crashing his motorcycle on King Avenue West tonight. The call came in around 8:30 this evening with a report of a motorcycle accident at King Avenue and Fallow Lane near Shiloh. Now, according to Billings Police Sergeant Nate West, the man was riding side by side with another motorcycle when he lost control of his bike and crashed into a curb. He was transported what were described as serious injuries, but was later pronounced dead at the hospital. He was wearing a helmet. Alcohol and speed are considered factors in this crash. A disturbance on the Billings rims this morning sent three teenage girls running from police and ended with one of them falling off the rims. Authorities responded around 11 o'clock to the rims just above North 27th Street. As they approached the vehicle looking for five suspects, three teenage girls jumped out of the car and ran. One of them, a 14-year-old, fell off the rims. The girl was found unconscious but breathing. First responders moved quickly to rescue her and then transported the girl back up the rims. No word tonight on the girl's condition. Police say they arrested one of two males, 18-year-old Malik Toure, allegedly involved in the initial disturbance. Well, flames that tore through South Billings' home this afternoon sent one person to the hospital and caused $200,000 in damages. The Billings Fire Department responded just before noon to 425 Bird Street. Battalion Chief Jason Lyon says the house was already 50% involved when firefighters arrived. One of the people in the home suffered minor smoke inhalation and was transported to St. Vincent Healthcare. The cause of this blaze is now under investigation. And some sad news out of Thailand tonight as a former Thai Navy SEAL working to rescue the stranded soccer team has died. The former SEAL joined the operation to try and help but died about 12 hours ago due to lack of oxygen. The diver was attempting to return to a command center about a mile inside the cave. Rescue efforts had previously considered teaching the team how to swim and navigate the treacherous cave system, but this death has raised even more concerns. Up next in tonight's 10 o'clock news, when it comes to mosquitoes, they are everybody's enemy. Find out how to make the best battle plan. And later in sports, Scott unveils the state's number two defensive back on our list of Montana's all-time great players.
You're watching MTN News with Jay Cohn and Janelle Slade. Storm Tracker weather with Bob McGuire and sports with Scott Green. This is the 10 o'clock news on Q2. Montana's news leader.